as exposed by Professor Richard Swinburne, and let's say some, let's say, mainstream currents of Orthodox theology. First of all, how do we change? A brief historical introduction. I'd like to point out that there is a patristic distinction on which modern Orthodox theology is based between the oti, that is the fact of God's existence, the ti, the what, and the how of God. And this means that the Eastern theology has integrated natural theology, as the Fokin has brilliantly shown, but mainly in order to prove the existence of God, while there were also the other two questions. And the distinction is basically that the oti can be known to natural theology, so natural theology is integrated. The what is not accessible to human knowledge, whereas the how, a personal mode of existence and manifestation of the essence through the energies, can be participated, even though there are some important variations of this schema in different ages of Byzantine thought. I think that an assessment of Richard Swinburne is very just. In the introduction of his great book, he writes, "The deep conviction of the possibility of reaching a fairly well-justified conclusion by rational argument on the issue of the existence of God was explicitly acknowledged by the vast majority of Christian philosophers from the 13th to the 18th centuries, and was shared, although discussed only briefly, by most Christian and non-Christian philosophers from the 1st to 12th centuries." So we have something which was more implicit in the 1st century and becomes more explicit after the 12th century. I'd like to point out that the medieval Eastern thought does not seem to present elements of irrationalism or fideism, such as those we find in Tertullian or encounter in some modern interpretations of Eastern theology. Having taken this into account, we could move into modernity. Very briefly, we have a critique of medieval natural thought in continental thought, after Immanuel Kant mostly. And also we have a very harsh critique in early analytic thought. In ordinary language philosophy, we have the idea that natural theology involves using words in very misleading senses, but what is a progress in the critique of natural theology is the claim of logical positivism that natural theology is not only false, but nonsensical. The reemergence in analytic philosophy takes place, I think, you might correct me, to the use of modal logic. In a more progressed form of modal logic, where we distinguish between necessity and contingency, and we have the notion of possible worlds. A possible world described as exhaustive description of a world that could be the real one from a metaphysical point of view, or as an exhaustive conjunction of propositional contents that could be true at the same time. This notion of possible worlds in the early analytic philosophy has led to a new breakthrough in analytic philosophy. So I would like to point out, as a response to Professor Swinburne's paper, I'd like to point out some elements in order to bring them to dialogue with mainstream Orthodox thought. A first element that we have a favor of inductive argumentation, which aims to explain experience. We have probabilism, probable arguments instead of necessary ones, and we have cumulative probable arguments. Thus, theism is not proved by a single decisive argument, as for example the logical argument used by Anselm or Descartes, but by the accumulation of a series of probable arguments that are combined. These arguments are, of course, a composite world, laws of nature. You heard all that in Professor Swinburne's paper. Taken together, these probable arguments point to the direction of a God who would care about the moral and cognitive progress of created conscious beings, who can employ the normality of the material world to their advantage. advantage, namely to a goal or advance, also overcoming obstacles. So the problem of evil is also explained thus. A decisive leap in its accumulation of probabilistic arguments is a religious and mystical experience of people who have come to partake in God, usually some sort of transcendent experience, which had, however, the nature of concrete perception of the divine. Professor Swinburne also has points some criteria, it's a simplicity. God is simply migrating all other particular causes in a single whole. And the infinity of God contributes to his simplicity as a cause, since finitude is linked to composition. The same is true about omnipotence, omniscience, and goodness. And secondly, coherence. And thirdly, the interpretative range. So God is an explanation because of these three criteria. I will now try to bring this into dialogue with mainstream currents of Orthodox thought. Even though Richard Swinburne's thought could be conceived as a modern actualization of Thomas Aquinas' thought, I think some ideas of his are also at home in the Orthodox Church of which he is a member. I point out the emphasis on the free will, his views on the problems of evil, and the emphasis on the personal and free character of possession. Also, as he has pointed out, he tries to seize the properties also as energies, so to combine Aquinas and Palamas. In my view, I think that putting aside the theological argument for more inductive and probabilistic ones is in tune with the empiricism that is particular to the Orthodox tradition, even if the latter did not know of induction as we know nowadays. We have the element of the decisive importance of the experience of the saint, this very Orthodox, and probably leaves room for faith, so we don't have an exclusion of faith. The importance attributed to simplicity is also in tune with Orthodox, with modern Orthodox theology. And also we have a lack of fides that we find in the natural theology of other analytic thinkers, such as Alvin Plantinga. On the other hand, I think Richard Swinburne offers something to Orthodox thought. He offers an intellectual curiosity and the valorization of scientific progress. And the title of my paper was God's Detectives. Detectives plays a role in Richard Swinburne's argumentation, but I think detective is something we could also see, let's say, in the actualization of Maximus the Confessor's thought, because the logoi are hidden, and somehow the wise man or the saint is someone who tries to be a detective and to detect what is this logoi. And this detective tries to detect not only signs of goodness, but also signs of evil. Why, for example, why God has permitted the existence of evil. So the detective is also someone who detects not only the goodness, but also the reason, let's say, he also detects a crime, namely the reason for evil. Lastly, a very interesting thing is that in Dr. Swinburne's thought, we have Trinitarian theology as somehow progressing, we progress to Trinitarian theology somehow just after natural theology in an organic way. Maybe I think this is a progression compared to Aquinas or to medieval natural theology. Whereas it is the incarnation which is really contingent. So we have this progression from natural theology to Trinitarian theology, which is quite interesting. I'm not sure, I don't know if this is in tune with Orthodox theology. As you all know that, I would just like to point out that we have sociology in which I think natural theology does play a role. In the Neo-Palamite theology, we have an emphasis on the energies as a complete participation of mind, reason, and body. So even though natural theology does play a role in Gregory Palamas and maybe any Neo-Palamite theology, we have mostly an emphasis on the complete experience. instead of just rational argumentation. In existential, in modern existential theology, instead of the person, which starts from Berdyaev and even earlier, I think we have some new entry of irrationalism. For example, you all know Dostoevsky, who says in the Note from the Underground that 2 and 2 equals 4 is something that goes against my freedom. These ideas from the Russian thinkers, Dostoevsky, but Berdyaev and others, point to a new entry of irrationalism in Orthodox thought, which was not exactly the case in the medieval time. I would like to see three exponents, one affirmative and two critical of natural theology, and then end with some open questions. What is the time?
If you're always the 7 actors, so it's 7.
Yes. So we have firstly an active, an affirmative natural theologian, the Mitrus Aniloae. What is peculiar about his theology is a theology of continuity between the natural and the supernatural. And I'd like to point out that Theologian does employ a specific argument of natural theology, such as those that we will see. This is performed in a general vision where the natural and the supernatural are in a continuation. And this is, he interprets St. Maximus the Confessor, but what he does is a theology of motion and evolution. This is inherited by the Aristotelian theology of motion by St. Maximus, but he also tries to bring in dialogue with modern currents of scientific thought. But his characteristic is an ironic or conciliatory way to see evolution, and not this. So there is an open question if Staniloae really takes into account Darwinism, because he takes into account the evolution, but the evolution, let's say, in a more conciliatory way. He also brings much of thought in dialogue with Heisenberg and with other. With other currents, noting how the perception of logoi by the human intellect is also a subjective stance. So it is man that gives meaning to nature. He does make specific arguments of natural theology, such as that the rationality of the universe, the logical character of the universe, points to the existence of a rational God and logos. And we have a full-blown anthropic principle in Staniloae, namely that, of course, we do find that in St. Maximus, this anthropic principle, as is pointed out by Humbert, but in Staniloae, we have an emphasis on consciousness, which is quite modern. So, created consciousness and the ability of communication is the purpose of the universe, and the existence of human consciousness points to the existence of a God. In general, we have a renewed emphasis on intellection in Staniloae, in anthropology, which I think is in tune with Professor Swinburne's anthropology from an analytic philosophical point of view. Now I would like to pass to a harsh criticism of natural theology by Christos Giannaras. Christos Giannaras' project, that is interesting, is deep. He also employs the same given of 20th century science, but in a different project as I go ahead. He tries to show how this science of the 20th century destroys or deconstructs, one might say, the Western medieval worldview. And by that, thus, he tries to show the importance of Orthodox apophaticism. This project is regarded modernly. By modernism, I mean this area between 1910 and 1960, approximately, where we have existentialism, personalism, modern art, etc., but not postmodernity. So Yanaras tries to regard modernism as the failure of the medieval West and postmodernity as the failure of modernity. I have detected four important critiques of natural theology. Firstly, the identification of natural theology with religion as opposed to the ecclesia. This is an element that we find in Barth and von Heffer, which are not an immediate interest in Yanaras, but an immediate one through his general German background. We have a personal and existentialist view of rationality as necessity as opposed to personal freedom, so natural theology is considered as unfree. We have the denunciation of natural theology as an effort to conquer God and to acquire individual certainty. And lastly, we have natural theology as apologetics in a bad sense, meaning that somehow it's an arrear-guard battle against modernity. So instead of giving an arrear-guard battle, we should really be in tune with what is very peculiar in modern science, etc. I'd like to point to the question if we have in Yanaras a sort of ecclesiological fideism. We don't really don't have a kind of Protestant fideism, an individualistic one, or some that we encounter in Kierkegaard, for example. But we might have a fideism of the community. This means that the whole of the community trusts God, but by trusting God, faith is a trust which is turned against natural theology. So the rejection of natural theology is somehow a victory of faith. However, Yanaras attempts rational proofs in the argumentation. He might not be against natural theology altogether in the sense of physici theoria, which is something slightly different or totally different. Yanaras does have a form of metaphysics regarding God as the cause and the goal of the universe, and identifies the logos with the energy. When we proceed to His Eminence John of Pergamon, he uses the theology of person as Yanaras, but in a different way. He emphasizes this distinction. What I'd like to point out, what is interesting, that Professor Zizoulas might say very similar things to Professor Swinburne about the Trinity, but from a totally different methodology. The methodology of John Zizoulas is that we have a sort of event of the resurrection, and this event of the resurrection of Christ is interpreted by hermeneutics, but sometimes he even speaks of the resurrection of Christ as a principle of real deduction. So Zizoulas tries to show that if the Christ is resurrected, for example, then he is a God, but if he's also human. But if, for example, the love we experience in the community points to a Trinitarian, points to a God who is love in himself and not only in relation to the world, so this God must be a plurality of persons, and these persons, it is likely that there will be a Trinity in order to avoid, let's say, a sort of catoptric mirror-like relation. Even though Zizoulas, in contradistinction to Swinburne, does not think that the exact number 3 would be used. But I think we could rephrase the René Descartes cogito ergo sum. I think that Zizoulas would say, we are because we are loved, and they are the cogito, a sort of Orthodox cogito, points to a plurality of divine persons.
What is the time?
Yeah, just 17 after, so.
Yes, we come forward. What is peculiar about John Zizoulas is an ecclesial hermeneutics instead of both natural theology and the metaphysics we find in other people like Yanaras. Hermeneutics lead to dogmatic theology with an eschatological character. So what Zizoulas points is that all of nature, of the logos of nature, are integrated in the logos as a person. And this person of the Logos points to the eschatological character of the Logos. So nature is not what we see now. Nature is what we will observe in the eschaton, in the afterlife. And so if there's a natural theology points to the future, not to this current state of the world. And thus it can only, and thus whatever hermeneutics of the world that leads to the future. I would like to conclude by some open questions. After these thinkers, there has been a criticism on their personalism or existentialism. In what concerns us here, I think that a new element in these thinkers is their irrationalism. At some point, not totally, and contemporary, a mainstream current in contemporary Orthodox theology is what I would term the theology of dialogue. This means that this theology of dialogue is an interpretation of Maxwell the Confessor and Gregory Palamas, in the sense that the logoi and the energies lead to a synergy between God and man. The open questions are the following. Can natural theology, and I will leave the floor for discussion, can natural theology be reconciled with an ecclesial understanding of knowledge? So when we do natural theology, would we do it in a cafeteria or elsewhere, or do we really point to an ecclesial experience? And how could natural theology be integrated in the ecclesial experience? Secondly, for example, St. Maxwell the Confessor and all other fathers, usually purification is needed for the knowledge of God. So there's sort of dynamic that first you are purified and then you have the natural contemplation. Also, I'd like to point out that there is God's hide and seek. There's a combination of natural theology and apophaticism. So what is the region of apophasis? I think Professor Swinburne gives us some insight when he points, when he has his theory of evil, which gives explanations, which also uses the evil character of the world as an argument for God's existence, which is very original. I'd like to ask the question, what do we achieve by argument of natural theology? Do we really convince modern people, or we just try to claim that we are rational and not irrational, as logical positions would have it? And lastly, I'd like to point out that natural theology is very important for our presence in the public sphere. In this sense, it could be, in a good sense, a reactualization of apologetics. I mean that in the second century, we had the apologetics with the aim of showing the rational character of Christianity in the Roman Empire. Today, where we have a new kind of globalization, natural theology is very important for entering the public sphere, as Professor Swinburne does, and arguing with other thinkers in order to show that the Christians share the same public sphere with non-Christians and do have a vision about the common future of humanity. Thank you very much.